Jesus. He's in the church. So whenever you hear somebody say, well, I believe in Jesus, but I don't need to be a part of the church. Jesus is standing in the church. He's with the church. You can't separate Jesus from the church. It's like separating a head from a body. It doesn't work. It doesn't last very long. So Jesus is standing in the church. One like the Son of Man, he's the Messiah, the glorified Son of Man who rides the clouds up into heaven and is given all power and honor and glory and kingship and wealth and honor of the nations. And so he's got this royal power just from that title that, of course, he's already glorified in his vision. But he's wearing an ankle-length robe with a gold sash around his chest. In the Old Testament, when the high priest, on the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, when he would sacrifice a bull, and they did that once a year, why? To remind him that they sinned way back when, and Moses went up the mountain, and they couldn't wait for him, and they made a golden calf, and worshiped a golden calf. After that, Aaron, who made the golden calf, and becomes high priest, he has to kill a bull every year to remind them and the people, stop worshiping animals. Worship God, maybe. So every year the high priest had to kill a bull, and they sacrifice the bull, and he'd get the bull's blood, he'd dress it in all these vestments. They were like light blue, and they had the 12 stones, or the 12 tribes of Israel, the breastplate, a little minor one. You go in, and they sprinkle the blood on the mercy seat for the angels. The cherubim angel wings would meet on top of the Ark of the Covenant. And then he would say his prayers, and then he'd come back out, and he'd change his clothes. He'd change his vestment. And then he'd put on an ankle-length robe and put a gold sash around his chest, and he'd go out and he'd bless the people with his right hand. And when he did that, he would tell the people, I did the sacrifice the way it was supposed to be done, the way Moses was told. Aaron was told to sacrifice the bull, sprinkle the bull's blood. I did that. And now your sins are forgiven. So the sacrifice is done, and now the benediction of forgiveness is given. So what's Jesus doing? He's telling us he's the new high priest. His sacrifice is finished, and our sins are forgiven. Every Sunday, Jesus appears in the eyes of faith like this. I mean, if we saw him, I'll drop dead like John did. What would the priest do? Couldn't have a lectionary. You're all dying, right? But Jesus reaches with his right hand and says, do not be afraid. So we step into the presence of Christ every Sunday in that glorified fashion. It's veiled. In the Word, in us, in the priest, in the Eucharist. And we should have a little bit of fear, holy fear. And not let ourselves get too comfortable. I mean, God wants us not to be afraid. But we still have to have some kind of holy fear. And when we walk into church, and the church building is consecrated, we walk in front of the Eucharist, we walk into liturgy, we should be ready to worship Christ. And when we do that, what does he do? He extends his right hand and blesses, lifts us up. Do not be afraid. I'm the first and the last, the one who lives. Once I was dead, but now I'm alive forever and ever. Never to die again. And this image of divine mercy should remind us of that. That's why we need it. We need to see it often. We need to be reminded of it often. Because we will forget. And God knows that. And of course, Faustina had many other prophecies. You know, she wrote the diary, and it was close to 700 pages. She only had a third-grade education. And when the theologian started to plow through her diary, they discovered that she hardly made any grammatical mistakes. And she wrote like a theologian. So it was a miracle that she even wrote that diary, but she did. And Jesus even called her his secretary of mercy. And he reveals much about baptism, about the Eucharist, about the sacrament of penance, holy confession. about the holy orders the priests had. Look what we have. We have so much in our church, and we yawn sometimes. And part of that is because we just don't know enough. I don't know enough. I don't know enough. And the more I know, the more I want to know more about what I don't know. And so that's why it's so important that we keep studying, we keep listening to talks, we keep coming to days like this. We hear some teaching in the homily, we hear, we pray together, we do the devotions, we prepare ourselves for the Eucharist. Because the Lord wants us to be ready. I'll end this one little part. I was reading some more things on my mercy. And Jesus reveals to Faustina one of the other main reasons why he appeared to her at that time, not only because World War I, communism, World War II was coming, hatred, all kinds of things happening to undermine the church, all kinds of terrible things were happening, and they're still happening, but there was a lot more happening then. He said, the reason I came is so that the world could be ready for my second coming. What is that? And he says, I want to give them the day of mercy now so they'll be ready for the day of justice. And then he showed Faustina a sign. What was the sign of the end times? And this is put in perspective. The end times started with Jesus' resurrection. So how long are the end times? However long. So don't be afraid of that. But we need to be ready no matter what, when it comes. But Jesus showed a sign to us. Here's a sign. Right before I come, there'll be a cross in the sky. It'll be lit up in the sky. Everyone will see the cross in the sky. And so if you see a cross in the sky, be ready, right? Say the name of Jesus. Make the sign of the cross. Powerful image. But this happened in Jerusalem in the year 349. In Jerusalem, 350 AD, St. Cyril of Jerusalem, he was the bishop, he's the patriarch in Jerusalem. And they had a brand new church there, it was maybe 15, 20 years old, the Holy Sepulchre Church in Jerusalem. They built it over the place where Jesus was crucified, and he rose from the dead, it was only a few yards from where he was crucified. They built this huge church over it. Constantine financed it, and he had died, and his son had taken over, and he became a heretic, Constant. Anyway, he was persecuting St. Cyril of Jerusalem because he stayed Catholic. Anyway, on Good Friday, year 350, St. Cyril writes about a vision that happened over the city of Jerusalem. A luminous cross appeared over the city from 12 to 3 p.m. on Good Friday. Everyone saw the cross in the sky. The pagans, there were Jewish people there, Christians, they all saw the cross. For 3 hours, at the time that Jesus died in Jerusalem, in the year 350. And guess where they all ran to when they saw the cross? The Church of the Holy Sepulchre. And St. Cyril said, all the people rushed into the church. It was cram-packed with people. They weren't humanists, a lot of them were Christian. And they prayed, and they venerated the cross, and because they had a true cross with them in the church at the time. And St. Cyril says, this is the sign of the coming of the Son of Man. And he said, God revealed it to us at our time as a warning.